Those who are welcome.
Church and happy Sabbath to you. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom should I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Whom should I be afraid? One thing I have desired the Lord, that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord, and to inquire in his temple. Let's bow our heads and ask God present to be with us on this blessed Sabbath. Our Father and our God, what a joy to call thee our Father on this blessed Sabbath. We thank thee, O God, for being with us throughout this past week. Lord, you've been with us. You protected us. You sustained us. So now to worship you in truth and in spirit, we invite thy presence to be with us. And let all God's people say, amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Happy Sabbath. We're going to sing today, Lift Him Up. Amen. That's page 371. We're going to sing the first, second, and then the interlude, and then the last verse, which is the fourth verse.
Lift him up as he that is, let the Lord look in me. Yeah.
at the Sabbath Day Church. It's prayer time for the people. This morning, my heart goes out for the victim's father. This is this morning, Mark Finger and the loss of his loved one, the victim of the prayer. Well, we'll take it from the top. How's that? This morning we have so many in our midst that needs prayer. We'll lift up our physician, Marcus Craven, the loss of loved ones. Continue to pray for him and his family as well, that the Holy Spirit would comfort them during the loss of a loved one. Special prayer this morning goes out for Sister Dorothy Jordan. She had a fall in her home, so that's why she's not here today, so continue to pray for her. Pray for my mother. She's doing just a little bit better. Thank you for your visits. Thank you for your prayers as well. Also remember Colina Dennison. She in dire need of your prayers. And brothers and sisters, we need to pray for our school. Not just, Lord, bless our school, but ask the Holy Spirit, what can I do for our school? Visits, or go in your pocketbook, or your wallet, or your bank account, and support our school as well. Are there any special requests before we pray this morning? Any special requests before we pray? Yes. Come on down, my friend. Sister Young, come on down. Anyone else need to come down for special prayer? You want special prayer this morning? Come right down. Yes, Doug.
I have a cousin named Cynthia. I want you to pray for her, please.
For Cynthia? Okay. Pray for the cousin. That can kneel, let us kneel. And if there's anything on your heart, anything that you're struggling with this morning, ask the Holy Spirit to come right in and remove whatever you're going through. Because we want to have a sound relationship with our Heavenly Father. Our Father in heaven, words cannot express our gratitude for your goodness and for your love. We thank thee, O God, from the rising of the sun to the going down of the same. You've been an excellent provider for us, food on our tables, a roof over our heads, and means to support ourselves and our families as well. But we thank thee for Jesus and the ultimate sacrifice that made on Calvary's cross. So, Heavenly Father, we continue to pray this morning for all of our sick, all of our shut-in, all of our bereaved families. A special prayer goes out for Felicia's daughter. We continue to pray for Doug's cousin that things would go well with her as well. We pray for the young man that lost his life down in Huntsville. Such a tragedy. So, Lord, we continue to pray for him and all those young men who's involved as well. We continue to pray for our church family that you be with us, unite us as one, to work together, to love together, and to move this church forward as well. Heavenly Father, we continue to pray for our school. We all can do something to better our school. It only takes one to lead one, to bring one, and our school will be a success. So, Lord, continue to be with our city. Lord, there's so much happening, not only with our city, with all the violence and the crime, but also in our nation as a whole. Bless our church leaders around the world. Bless our world leaders around the world. We realize, oh God, that these are truly the very last days upon earth history. So help us, oh God, to make our callings and election sure. We lift up Pastor Bentley this morning, that you would be with him, that you bless his message that they have for us today. We realize, oh God, he has studied hard and long for this message. We pray that we too receive a blessing from it. Now, Lord, continue to be with us throughout this day. For we ask in the precious name of Jesus. Let all God's people say, Amen.
I have but to have. Praise the Lord. Somebody, give us this day our daily bread. You said you would supply all my needs. According to your riches, I have but to ask, and I shall receive. This is a part that I love. To go from here and shed this love you gave to me. To show someone who's lost and help them find their way, the way to truth and faith, so they can be free. Like me, be free. Like me, oh Lord, we need your love. Oh Lord, we need your peace. Oh Lord, we need your joy on this day. Isn't that a beautiful prayer? I'm so glad to be in the house of God today. How about you? Amen. I want to welcome you to worship today. In the name of Jesus, I welcome you to the house of God, where we sing songs and we pray and we seek God's face and we hear his word and where we fellowship with each other so that we will be able to strengthen and encourage each other in the faith. We want to welcome you. A special welcome to those of you who are visiting with us today. We're so glad that you're in the service with us today. We know that you're not here by happenstance, but by divine appointment. At this time, we want to greet one another. We want to turn to our neighbors, our friends, and our visitors and extend to them a warm handshake and a hug and a smile. Let us welcome one another into the house of God right now.
I am a friend of God.
I am a friend of God. He must be
God. I am a friend of God.
I am a friend of God.
I am a friend of God. He must be
God.
I am a friend of God. I am a friend of people. You are my virtue, you are mindful of me. But you hear me when I call. Is it true that you are thinking of me? How you love me? It's amazing. I am afraid of God. I am afraid of God. I am afraid of God. He calls me proud. I am afraid of God.
Return to our seats. I want to share a few brief announcements with us as we continue with our worship service this morning. You have heard of the many individuals who are in need of prayer in our church family right now. We want to name just a few today. We remember Sister Kalita Dennison. We remember that recently she had heart surgery. And she was doing well, but then she had some complications from that surgery, and so she had to go back to the hospital. She's there now, and it would make a big, big difference if we were able to go by and to visit her and to let her know that we love and support her at this time. So we want to invite you to visit her. She is at Henry Ford Hospital. That's Kalita Dennison, Sister Kegler's daughter. We continue to remember Sister Caldonia Pickett in prayer. Sister Felicia Hunter and her daughter Charisse and their family, we want to lift them up in prayer. Remember Sister Dorothy Jordan in prayer, who suffered a fall. We want to pray that God would touch and heal her. And you have heard, most likely by now, of the tragedy that occurred at Oakwood University this past week as Carvel Goodlow, a student from here in Detroit, was tragically killed. And so we want to be praying for Carvel's family, for the Oakwood University family that is really connected throughout this country. There's so many people who have been hurt and traumatized and affected by this loss. We want to lift them up. We also want to pray for Brother Antoine Knight from the Detroit Center Church, as it is Antoine, through his group, his organization, Caught Up, that recruited Carvel and actually helped him to get to Oakwood, along with several other young men. And you can imagine the pain that that must be causing for him as someone who has wanted such good things for these young men, for such a tragedy to occur. So let's lift him up. The funeral is going to be this coming Tuesday at Burns Avenue Seventh-day Adventist Church at 11 o'clock. And so we want to invite as many of us as possible to go over and support on that day. We want our Burns family, as well as our Detroit family, to know how much we love and support them as their sister church here at City Temple. I plan to be there, and I hope that as many of us as are able to attend will plan to be there, as well as also lifting up this family in prayer and this situation. We are glad to receive a card from Brother Raymond Johnson Jr., Brother Raymond Johnson, as you remember, lost his father, Raymond Johnson Sr., not too long ago, and he sent a card to our church saying thank you to all of you. There is no mistaking the happiness that comes from knowing people with such kind and giving hearts. Thank you for your love, support, and prayers from the family of Raymond Dietrich Johnson Sr., that is. God bless Demetria, Tanalyn, Raymond Jr., and Matthew. And so we want to praise God for receiving this special thank you from them. And remembering, it is a reminder of the difference we make when we reach out. When we reach out, it takes every single one of us to reach out. Sometimes there's a such thing called the bystander effect, where everyone who hears of something thinks somebody else is going to reach out. Somebody else is going to help. But no, we must take personal responsibility to say, I'm going to reach out. I'm going to help. And you're able to stand on behalf of all of us. Who says amen to that? Amen. Amen. We want to continue to pray for our nominating committee as they meet tomorrow from 10 to 3 here at the church. We continue our work of nominating officers during this election season for our church officers for 2019-2020. We want to pray for the Lord to continue to lead the nominating committee, but I want to ask you to pray for something else. Pray that the other side of this process would work, and that is that when we call individuals to serve, that those individuals will really seek the Lord to know if the Lord is calling them to serve or not. Sometimes we can be tired and worn out. Sometimes we have a lot going on, and it's easy to just quickly say no. Sometimes we may be carrying all sorts of history that makes it easy to just say no. But we want to ask that we would be led by the Spirit of God, that we would be in prayer, all of us, asking God, Lord, prepare my heart so that if you send a call, that I'll recognize your voice and that I would not just say the first thing that comes to my mouth, but that I would actually say what you want. If you're calling me, give me grace to say yes. That's the other side of the process. The nominating committee is praying, but we need the church to be praying so that we will be responsive to the call of God through the Spirit and through his people when that call comes. Who says amen to that? I ought to hear a loud amen on that one, because it's easy. There's a bystander effect, and then there's just stand on the sidelines effect, right? But we want every member of our congregation, how many? Every member of our congregation engaged actively in ministry in some way. And that doesn't mean everybody has to be a leader, but all of us should have a mind to put our shoulder to the plow. Is that all right? Amen. Also, you have noticed in your bulletins that we have an appeal for items that will go in our Thanksgiving baskets this year. As you know, every year it's our practice as an outreach to put together baskets to give to those who will benefit from them in our community. So please take note in your bulletin of the items that you can purchase. You can begin purchasing some of these items now. And in November, the first few weeks in November, we're going to actually start making an appeal for us to bring those items here to church. We're going to bring them right up here and pray for them and pray for ourselves as we minister in this way. So please take note of that list in your bulletin so that you would be able to help in that way. Yes. That's right. Bring them now. Okay, I'm sorry. I was told that we're going to buy them now and then bring them up front in November. But you said bring them now. Okay, bring them now, everybody. That's Sister Watson, our community service leader. And she says we need those items right away. And so you see a long list here. And so me and my family, we're going to identify some items that we can bring. And we're going to bring those items in supply. And we are inviting everyone to do the same. This is something that we're all doing together as a church family. What do you say? And finally, before I sit down, as always, we want to continue to pray for our school, Peterson Warren Academy, and lift up our staff, our faculty, our students, and everyone that helps for the ministry of Christian education, Adventist Christian education, that's going on there. I like what Elder Gray said this morning. He said, let's not just pray and say, Lord, bless our school. right? And that's an okay prayer, but we just say, Lord, show me what I can do to be a part of this ministry so that I can help in some way. Lord, bless my heart, open my heart, that I will be able to be used by you for this very critical and important ministry. Somebody ought to say amen. Amen. May the Lord continue to bless us this morning as we worship him in spirit and in truth. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
The Bible says, see that you excel in this grace of giving. For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, so that you through his poverty might become rich. If the willingness is there, the gift is acceptable according to what one has, not according to what he does not have. Remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Will the deacons please stand as we prepare to receive the morning's tithes and offerings? As we bow our heads, Father, we thank you for the privilege of giving. We thank you for another blessed Sabbath day. We ask, Lord, that you would bless both the gift and the giver. Bless all that we have so that when we have given, there will still be plenty left to cover all our needs. These things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Blessings and glory and honor, they all belong to you. Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me. Just wanna praise you forever and ever.
Blessings flow.
Blessings flow.
Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning, church family.
Morning.
May you please stand for the scripture.
Amen.
Today's scripture will be found in Matthew 28:16-20. I'll say it again. Matthew 28:16-20. If you have it, please say amen.
Amen.
Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely I am with you always, to the very end of age." Amen, church family.
Amen.
Amen.
Bless the reading and the hearing of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
You may be seated, church. I wanted to take just a moment to acknowledge Sister Philpotts, who I see worshiping with us this morning. Her tall, strong son, Brian, there. And it's just a pleasure to see them. Make sure that you get a chance to greet her personally.
It's my pleasure this morning to introduce to us the speaker of the hour, who is no other than Pastor Darryl Bentley. He is the senior pastor of the Metropolitan Seventh-day Adventist Church and School. He's also the superintendent of District 12, which is the Metro Detroit area for the Michigan Conference. We call it in Lake Region being area leader. He's the area leader for this area. He's been the pastor of Metro since May of 2015, though he's been a pastor in the Michigan Conference since 2008. Pastor Bentley and his wife, Ginger, hail from North Carolina. And you can tell in one specific regard in that both of them exhibit a very warm Southern hospitality. Their union has been blessed by three children. I understand that they're in their teen years, in the middle of the teen years, 16, 17, 18 years old, two boys and one girl. And I thought to myself, I've got to pray for Pastor Bentley because he's parenting in the teen years, something I do not yet know anything about. I know the trials of parenting for little ones, but he is in the thick of it, and we praise God for him and for his family that is actually a ministering family. In fact, the entire family is not here today because his daughter had an obligation to share about some ministry that she's been doing. They wanted to be here. Unfortunately, they're not. We hope that next time they will be able to be with us together. As I mentioned, Pastor Bentley is a big-hearted person. He not only loves family, his family, and God, but you can tell that he's a lover of people. He's so gracious, he's so outgoing, and he's one of the people that you meet, and instantly when you meet him, you realize he's someone who's easy to love. He's someone who's easy to love. More than that, he is a man of God, and he comes today bearing a message from God. He's a man filled with the Holy Spirit, and he has a zeal and a passion for the work of ministering, not only to those who don't know the Lord, but also to those who are God's people. I'm so glad that several months ago when we met, he and I were able to go and have lunch with each other, and we immediately agreed that we wanted to do more to bring our churches together. And so, as a result, we've invited him to come and share here at City Temple with us today. And next Sabbath, September 29th, we will have the privilege, my family and I, to go and minister at Metro. And so we're looking forward to that. We hope that this is just the beginning of many opportunities for our congregations to be able to fellowship together. After the hymn of meditation, the very next voice you will hear will be that of Pastor Darryl Bentley. We ask that you would pray for him and that our hearts, pray for ourselves, that our hearts would be open to hear the words of God's manservant. God bless you.
Hello. Thank you. This morning, saints. It is good to be in the house of the Lord. What do you say? Oh, come on now. I got three people that it says it's good to be in the house of the Lord. I said it's good to be in the house of the Lord. Amen? All right. Well, I want to say a huge thank you to my brother, to my colleague, to your pastor. Thank you for this special opportunity. And thank you so much for that impressive introduction. I am looking forward to meeting that brother someday. I bring you greetings this morning, this afternoon, not only from my beloved wife, who could not be with me because of obligations that Pastor Dwayne mentioned. I also bring you greetings from your sister church, the Metro Church. And I also have the privilege of pastoring the Farmington Church. And I also bring you greetings. I reached out to my conference president to let him know that I was coming to share this morning. And so I also bring you greetings from Elder Jim Mitchiff, our conference president. So thank you for this opportunity to be with you this morning. Saints, I believe that Jesus is coming soon. In fact, I love being a Seventh-day Adventist. I love it. I was not raised a Seventh-day Adventist, but I love being a Seventh-day Adventist because our name tells us what our business should be about. We are Seventh-day Adventists, so we are here on God's Sabbath. But we're Adventists because we're looking forward to the soon coming of Jesus. And today, I pray, it is my heart's desire that I might be able to share something that would draw you into a deeper relationship with Jesus and help you be more ready for his soon second coming. But before I begin, I am very mindful that I do not have the ability to speak. It is only through God speaking through me that I can have anything of any value to share. So would you permit me to pray one more time? Our loving Father God, Lord, I thank you. Thank you for the beautiful privilege that we have to meet you every Sabbath. And Lord, the Sabbath was not our invention. It was not our creation. Lord, we're simply coming to keep the appointment that you set. Father, this morning, as I stand before my brothers and sisters, Lord, I am very mindful that I have nothing of any value to share unless you give it to me. So, Father, I pray that you would please speak through me. Lord, hide me behind the cross. Let Jesus alone shine through today. And Lord, I lift up my brothers and sisters that are here, that are listening. But Lord, I pray that they would not listen passively. That they would just sit here and hear another sermon, walk out the door the same as when they came. So Lord, please send your spirit to minister to my brothers and sisters. Give them that meat that they need today in due season, that their lives too can be transformed by the power of your word. And Lord, please guide us on this journey, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Saints, I want to ask you a question as we get started. I have discovered that I actually learn a lot more, Elder, by asking questions. So I want to ask you a question. Have you ever been given the opportunity to play some sandlot basketball, baseball, or a pickup game on the court, or maybe some backyard football, and you had to have two captains, right? Because on every team, there's how many sides? At least two sides. And then those captains are given the challenge of choosing their teams. I was always one of those kids that was the last to be picked. Anybody relate to that? But finally, they figured out when it came to football that I actually had something to offer, right? And so I got picked a little sooner when it came to football down the road. But imagine you're given the opportunity to choose two teams, but imagine all of the people are people who have no idea how to play. Imagine that all the people from whom you have to choose are people that under normal circumstances you wouldn't choose at all. How well do you think your game's going to go? Well, friends, I submit to you this morning that that is the very task that was given to Jesus. Jesus was sent, and Jesus had to pick a team, yes or no? Now think about who Jesus had to choose from. Jesus couldn't go to the seminary. Right? I mean, let's put it in some modern equivalents, right? Let's put it in some terms that we understand. Jesus couldn't go to the seminary. I had the privilege of studying my undergrad degree at Southern Adventist University. But guess what? Jesus couldn't go to Southern. Jesus couldn't go to Oakwood. Why? Because in Jesus' day, what they were being taught did not match up with the scripture. Am I right? In fact, they were so messed up. They were so messed up. By the time that Jesus came, the time the Messiah was on the scene, they were so messed up that they didn't even know the Messiah was there. Can you imagine? The Messiah face to face, and yet you don't recognize him because you haven't been taught what Messiah was supposed to be about. You've been taught that Messiah was coming as a conquering king. And that was not the mission, amen? I mean, how do you read through the scripture? In the song, by his stripes we are healed. He was led as a lamb to the slaughter. John the Baptist, when he stood out on the banks of Jordan and looked out and saw Jesus, what did he proclaim? Behold the Lamb of God that does what? That gets rid of the Romans. That's what they wanted to hear, wasn't it? Behold the conquering king who gets rid of the Romans. John didn't say that. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. So Jesus, friends, I would submit to you, could not go to the established centers of learning in his day. Jesus was left with having to go to common folk, just like me and you. And where did he land? Upon the shores of Galilee. And what did he find there? Fishermen? Anybody like to fish? God bless you, I just can't pull it off. I tried going fishing as a young man, and two different times, the fish not only took my bait, but they jerked my pole, pulled off the bank. I decided if I was going to go fishing, I'd do it at a restaurant. And then I became Adventist. Fish is clean, some of it, right? I'm not trying to make anybody feel bad. But Jesus left with these fishermen. Fishermen, sailors, known for their quality of deportment. Known for their precision of language. Now listen, I'm not trying to put down anybody, but let's just be honest. When the disciples spoke, what was often said of them? These are unlearned men. Right? These are some guys that they sound like they're from the world because they were from the world. One of them was a tax collector. Now, Elder Joseph, they were held in the highest of esteem. Right? No. The Romans, when they came in, they not only taxed the people, they chose their own people to tax them. But at least they were honest, right? Anybody remember the story of Zacchaeus? That brother, he had to pay people back, and he took it a little step further. I'm not just going to pay them back. I'm going to pay them back fourfold. So here you have one of the disciples. He's a tax collector. And then you had one of them that was a politician. You ever heard of Judas? Judas, it is believed by scholars, was the only disciple who was not chosen by Christ, but chose himself. Jesus answered him, and he said, listen, foxes have dens, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. But yet Judas came and became part of the disciples. So notice this ragtag group of people. And friends, I'm here to submit to you this morning that not a single one of the men in Jesus' company would have been hired by any conference today. Am I telling the truth, Ed? Friends, it has become the case in many of our conferences around this globe that if you don't have a master's degree, we're not even going to interview you. That's true. Am I right? The conferences nowadays would not have touched the people that Jesus chose. And probably for good reason, amen? So Jesus, given this task of taking this ragtag, rough and tumble, socially unacceptable, politically ambitious group of men and trying to turn them into a force that would shake the world. And he only had 3.5 years to do it. Was he successful? Some would wonder. Would you agree with me about this, saints? That some of the last words that you share with people before you leave this earth are probably some of the most precious words and important words on your heart. Is that true? I'm telling you, when someone's about to pass out of this life, they're not worried about what the tigers just did. and they're certainly not worried about what the Lions did. I'm from North Carolina, but I've been paying attention, amen? You don't talk about those things because they're trivial. You talk about that which is important, yes or no? And so as Jesus is about to leave this earth, he spent 3.5 years with these men, trying to get them on track, and then after the resurrection, Acts chapter 1 tells us that he had an additional 40 days that he spent with the disciples. And you would think that they were good to go. You would think that they were all set, that they were ready to graduate. But I'm here to tell you, they were still messed up. How many Gospels are there in the Bible? Come on, I'm in an Adventist church. 4, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. We're going to go in reverse order today. And we're going to look at Jesus' commission to the disciples. You have your Bibles? Now, I know I saw the AV team putting verses on the screen, but friends, don't let the screen because you become biblically illiterate. Open your own Bible. Get in the habit of knowing where the things are in Scripture yourself. And first, we're going to go to John chapter 21. John what? John 21. How many of you were blessed today by the Scripture reading? That young lady did a fantastic job, didn't she? Some of us adults can take a lesson from her. She stated the Scripture. She waited a moment to let people find it, and then she restated the Scripture. Did you catch that? I don't know who trained her, but praise God, amen? Thank you, young lady. So John chapter 21 and verse 15, are you with me? So when they had eaten breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me more than these? He, speaking of Peter, said to him, speaking of Jesus, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Now friends, you and I have one limitation when it comes to the Scriptures. Most of us only read English. Some of you may read some Spanish or other languages, but the New Testament was written in Koine Greek. Have you heard that before? Of course you have. So you know that there's three different words that can express love translated in English from the Greek. Have you heard that before? Of course. So one of those words is agape, right? Agapao. That agape love is that love that even though I know you, I still love you. I heard one brother put it one time, agape love is I love you roots and all. I like that. Then there's phileo, right? You ever heard of Philadelphia? Of course, right? That brotherly love. In fact, Philadelphia means the city of brotherly love, right? And then there's a third word, eros, which we get our word erotic, right? So it's a little different type of love. We might not even call it love. Right? So here's why I'm telling you this. When Jesus asked Peter, notice what he says, do you love me? Jesus uses the word agape. And he says to Peter, Peter, do you agape me? In other words, do you love me unconditionally? How do you think Peter responds? He doesn't use agape. Peter's response is, yes, Lord, you know that I phileo you. How many of you find that interesting? Wait a minute. Peter, do you love me unconditionally? Well, yes, Lord, you know I love you like a brother. That's a little different, isn't it, when we hear how it comes from the original language. Jesus persists another time. Verse 16, are you with me? He said to him again a second time, Simon, son of Jonah, do you? Now, it says love in your Bible, but which word do you think it does again? Agape. Simon, son of Jonah, do you agape me? He said to him, yes, Lord, you know that I love you how? Like a brother. Twice now, Jesus has put him on the spot among the other disciples. Twice now, he has asked him unconditionally, and twice now, Peter has responded, I love you like a brother. And friends, let's put a little context to this. What had recently happened to Peter? All of you are going to abandon me, Jesus said at the Last Supper. But Peter, what was his response? Oh, Lord, not me. Lord, I'll even die for you. And what did Jesus say to him? Before the cock crows twice, thou shalt deny me thrice. I love the rhyme in there from the old King James. It's beautiful. So Peter, did he go through a bitter fall? The Peter before the denial would have said to Jesus proudly, oh, of course, Lord, I agape you. But now Peter had had a lesson in humility. But let me ask you, is 3.5 years with somebody, living with them day and night, is that long enough to get to know them well? Anybody here prior military? Let me see your hands, veterans. Praise the Lord. Thank you for your service. I had the privilege of serving with the United States Army. Spent Hua, I heard it. Hua is the Army, amen. Spent 12 months in Iraq, deployed with the Army. Army basic training, when I went through, was 10 weeks. In 10 weeks, you come out different people, don't you? You come out as a team, don't you? You come out as a cohesive unit because you have collective training, collective suffering. And my drill sergeants made sure we had plenty of collective suffering. You feel me? We had this one kid. He was built like a rock. And that's what he would tell the drill sergeant when the drill sergeant was doing what they called smoking us. And he would holler out from the crowd, drill sergeant, you can't smoke a rock. And we'd start kicking him in the head to be quiet. So what I'm saying to you is when you suffer through things together, you should be merged together, yes or no? When you have a collective history, when you have a collective suffering, there's a bond that pulls you together that not just anybody can break. Is that right? So why then, at the end of 3.5 years, did Peter not know Jesus enough to really love him the way he should? But Jesus doesn't leave us. Notice what Jesus does. Are you still with me in John 21? He, speaking of Jesus, said to him, speaking of Peter the third time, Simon, son of Jonah, do you phileo me? Notice what happens, friend, when you and I do not have the ability. And we do not have the ability. Don't get it in your head. Don't get it in my head that we have the ability. We cannot come up to where Jesus is unless he first comes down to where we are to bring us where he is. Does that make sense? Jesus is in the business of coming down where we are that he can bring us up to where he is. I love what it says in Steps to Christ. When the prophet is speaking about prayer, she speaks to the question that really is posed in Matthew chapter 6, verse 8. It says, before we even speak, the Lord knows what we have need of. And so some people, they get it in their mind, they say, well, if God knows everything, why do I need to bother to pray? And she reminds us in Steps to Christ that prayer is not about informing God. It's about getting us in connection with divinity. And Jesus is trying to connect with Peter. And guess who else he's trying to connect with today? And you. So I would submit to you, this is happening just before Jesus ascends back to heaven. And let me ask you this question. Did the disciples love Jesus the way that they should love him? They did not. How many of you have been in the church more than 10 years? I was not raised a Seventh-day Adventist myself. We claim to be Baptist, but that's because that's what my grandmother was. But I'm going to tell you, I can claim to be anything that doesn't make it true, right? I can stand next to a boat dock and claim to be a boat. Does that make me a boat? I can stand in my garage and claim to be a car, but that doesn't make me a car. I can sit in a church every week and claim to be an Adventist, but that doesn't make me an Adventist. Am I right? I can walk with Jesus and claim to be one of his closest disciples, but that doesn't make me a disciple. Just before the commission, Jesus was about to commission a group of men who did not love him the way that he deserved to be loved. Are you with me? Continuing our journey backwards, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. So where are we headed now? We're headed to Luke 24. What we're going to continue to do is piece together a picture of how the disciples looked just before Jesus' ascension to heaven. Luke 24. And about verse 36, if you would, please. Amen, if you're there. Have mercy if you need a little time. Mercy's a good thing, isn't it? Now notice, saints, verse 36. As they said these things, Jesus himself stood in the midst of them. Let's give a little context to this real quick. Are you familiar with the story of the disciples with whom Jesus walked to Emmaus? If there was ever a Bible study that I want to be a part of, that was it. I mean, right? It's right after the resurrection. And these guys are walking, they're kind of discouraged, they're kind of downtrodden, and along comes this stranger. They didn't know it was Jesus, right? But along comes this stranger and starts walking with them, and he asks them, well, what's going on? And basically they ask him, have you been in a cave? Which he had been, oddly enough. But basically, have you been living in a cave? Do you not know what's happening? And so as they began to walk those few miles back to Emmaus, it says that Jesus opened all the scriptures to them. That's a Bible study that I'd want to be a part of. How about you? And they walk all the way, and they make their way to Emmaus, and it's time to sit down and have something to eat. And they said, come on in there, eat with us. Oh, no, I've got to go. No, please. They persisted. That's a powerful thing in Middle Eastern culture. People like to be asked more than once. And so if they tell you no the first time, keep asking. So that's why they persisted with Jesus. And then when they sit down and the food was about to be blessed, they realized it was who? Jesus, and he was gone. That's the context of now where we land in Luke 24. These guys, after they realized it was Jesus, they were so excited. They were so blown away that they go running all the way back to Jerusalem. They find the disciples and they say, guess what happened? Friends, that's the way we should be in sharing what Jesus has done for us. What do you say? So many times we sit around like we've got nothing to contribute, and we really should be telling the world what Jesus has done for us. So verse 36, are you with me now? Now as they, the guys from Emmaus, said these things, Jesus himself stood in the midst of them and said to them, peace to you. Now friends, have you ever heard that song? I'm sure you have. It's a song called I Can Only Imagine. Mercy me. I can only imagine what I will do. Right? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Will I fall? What are you going to do the first time that you see Jesus? I have no idea. I just want to be there. I don't care if I faint and fall flat on my face. I want to be there. Amen? Notice their response in verse 37. Tell me if this is what you want to mimic. But they were, what? Terrified and frightened. And suppose they had seen a what? Oh, wait a minute. Maybe it's because Jesus didn't tell them he was going to be resurrected from the dead. Is that what happened? Was Jesus deficient in sharing with them what would happen? No. Do you think that by the time 40 days had passed, that there were people who had seen Jesus and heard about his resurrection? Absolutely. And yet, what's their response when Jesus comes back on the scene? I'm terrified. I'm frightened. And suppose they had seen a spirit. Notice how Jesus responds to them in verse 38. And he said to them, why are you troubled and why do what? Doubts arise in your heart. Behold my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Handle me and see, for a spirit does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have. But notice verse 41. While they still did not believe, for joy and marveled, he said to them, have you any food here? So he took some fish and some honeycomb and he ate it. Now notice verse 45. He opened their understanding that they might do what to the scriptures? What does that indicate? If my mind has to be opened to understand, is that or is that not an indication that prior to that I did not understand? Does that make sense? So friends, after 3.5 years of serving side by side with Jesus, did they still know anything? So let's recount the characteristics that describe the disciples. So far, we've seen that they didn't love him the way that he should be loved, yes or no? So far, we've seen that they were terrified at his presence. We've seen that they did not have a solid understanding of Scripture. Is all this being borne out in the Bible so far? So this is not Pastor Bentley's speculation. I'm simply pointing to you what the Bible says. Is that fair, yes or no? And I want you to see verse 50 so that you can see that I'm not telling you a story, that this happened just before the ascension. What does verse 50 say? He led them out as far as Bethany, lifted up his hands. 51, now as it came to pass, he blessed them, that he was parted from them and carried where? So friends, this is the disciples, 3.5 years after Jesus' ministry. This is the disciples an additional 40 days after the resurrection, and they're still messed up. Is there any hope for me? Let's continue to go backwards. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Where are we headed now? Luke. Nope. Mark. Mark 16, please. Mark 16. Let's pick up around verse 14. Mark 16. And I don't know which Bible you may be looking at this morning, but in mine I'm using the New King James Version. And it has these little titles. Anybody else got New King James? Do you see the title that's given above this section? What does it say? The Great Commission, right? Verse 14, let us look at it together. Later he, speaking of Jesus, appeared to the 11 as they sat at the table. And he rebuked, now notice the characteristics. He rebuked their what? Unbelief, and then what's the other characteristic? Hardness of heart, because they did not believe those who had seen him after he had risen. My goodness. Hardness of heart. Do you use that phrase very often in your home? I'll tell you what my mama used. Is that okay? I'm going to bring a little North Carolina up in here. So. My mama used to tell me, she said, boy, you are hard-headed. Anybody else have that distinction growing up? Anybody still have that biblical ratio? The Bible not only refers to it as hardness of heart, but in referring to the Jewish believers, they are referred to as what neck type of people? Stiff, right, why? Because God, you're going this way, and God wants to direct you this way, right? But because you're stiff-necked, you're fighting him. Hardness of heart speaks to the same thing, yes or no? Who else, as it relates to the Egyptian captivity, was referred to as having a hardened heart? Pharaoh. In fact, the Bible says that God is the one who hardened Pharaoh's heart. Do you remember reading that? I've had people question that, and they say, wait a minute. I thought God was supposed to be in the business of softening your heart. But friends, here's the problem. It's not that God's trying to harden your heart, but the effects of God upon your heart reveal what's there. Do you have a heart of stone, or do you have a heart of flesh? Another illustration that I really appreciate. The same sun that hardens the clay is the same sun that melts the wax. I want my heart to be melted under the love of God. How about you? But notice, this is the characteristics that describe the 11. Not just one of them, not just Peter. Peter wasn't the only one who didn't love Jesus the way he should. He rebuked the 11. He said to them, verse 15, here we see basically the parallel passage to what our young lady read earlier. Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. And we can read the rest of it. And then notice verse 19. After the Lord had spoken to them, he was received up into heaven. So friends, this is the very last things that Jesus said to them. And the condition of their hearts was they didn't love Jesus the way that they should. They had unbelief. They were frightened at the very presence of Jesus. They did not know the scriptures the way that they were supposed to. Are you still with me? And they had hard hearts. In other words, their heart was hard. It was not tender to what Jesus would want them to change and become. Do you see what I'm seeing? Yes or no? Let's back up now a little bit to Matthew. And in Matthew, we're going to go to 28. And we're going to pick up where the young lady read today. Matthew 28 and verse 16. And basically, all I want to read to you is the last word of verse 17. You see what it says? What's the word? How would you like that? The record of Scripture, it says that they worshiped him, but some of them what? Friends, I don't understand how you could know that Jesus was nailed to a cross, standing from a distance and see it, right? How can you stand from a distance and see Jesus nailed to a cross? See him finally cry out, "Into thy hands I commit my spirit." See that Roman centurion finally come up and thrust the spear into Jesus' side. The Bible says that the water and the blood ran forth. Are you with me? How could you witness that and then see that same man standing before you a few days later? How could you see that and still have doubt? Does anybody think that that just seems unbelievable? In closing, I want to ask you this question. What was the cure? Did you hear me? What was my question? And I'm asking the question, what was the cure for not loving Jesus the way that he deserved? What was the cure for not having solid belief in Jesus? What was the cure for doubt? What was the cure for being frightened? What was the cure for hardness of heart? Did you catch what the cure was? What was the cure? I get paid by the month. Talk to me. You get paid by the month? Lake Region paid by the month? I got all day. And I just got glasses. I finally reached an age where I have to have some glasses. And I'm kind of excited about it. Because now I can take them off. You just look smarter, right? You just So I will stand here and hold these glasses. And I will stand here and look at you. But I'm asking you, what was the cure? I told you, no, stay with me. Remember the context. These things were identified just prior to which event? The ascension. What do we say was given right at the ascension? Before the ascension was the Great Commission. Thank you, sis. All of these passages that we've just looked at, and including Acts chapter 1 that we did not turn to, but you remember verses 9 through 11, right? They stood there and they watched Jesus descend into the heavens, and then two of men appeared in white raiment. Two white men. I don't know what they look like. I probably should just pray now. Listen, stay with me. Stay with me. I don't know what they look like. All I know is that they're angels, right? Mercy. Wow. Soundboard's trying to cut my microphone. That's probably a good idea. Said, why stand ye gazing into the heavens? Am I right? The same Jesus will appear again to you in like manner, right? So we know that these passages are just before Jesus left, and we know that they're passages that were given just before the Great Commission. Are you with me so far? So if these are things that were said of the disciples just before the Great Commission, just before the ascension, what was the cure? Come on now. What did he tell them to do? Did he tell them to go back and review your history? Did he tell them to go back and study more? What did he tell them to do? What was the two-letter word that starts with a G and ends with an O? The cure, saints, is to get busy for the Lord. The cure for what ails you spiritually is to get focused off of yourself and onto somebody who needs Jesus. And can I make a statement to you? I know why the Seventh-day Adventist Church is messed up. Did I get your attention? I'm going to tell you why the Seventh-day Adventist Church is messed up. Because I'm in it. But guess what? It's messed up because you're in it. And I'm not saying that to put me down or to put you down. I'm simply saying to you, as long as humans do human things and function in human strength, we will always mess it up. Am I right? But if you and I will step away from our humanity, if we will step away from trying to focus on me, then I can actually let the Holy Spirit work through me and do what God has asked me to do. So the cure, if you sit here today as one who does not love Jesus the way he should, the cure, if you sit here today and you have doubts, the cure, if you sit here today and you don't know the scriptures the way you should, is to get busy telling somebody about Jesus. Now, I'm not saying that's all of it. Should I still pray? Yes or no? Should I still read my Bible? Yes or no? Should I still study my Sabbath school lesson and show up to Sabbath school? You see, I was baiting them. Friends, I'm not saying get rid of spiritual disciplines. But the real cure that Jesus focused on was to do the work that they had been given. Will you go with me lastly to Acts chapter 1? Acts chapter 1. In Acts chapter 1, beginning in verse 4. And being ascended together with them, he, Jesus, commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you have heard from me. For John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with what? With the Holy Spirit, not many days from now. Therefore, when they had come together, they asked him, saying, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? Is that but another proof that they were messed up? Wait for the Holy Spirit. Now, wait a minute, Jesus. Just before you go, how about getting rid of this Roman thing? How about getting rid of this messed up administration? I'm saying, there's times we look at the political spectrum, and I'll be honest with you, I'm not happy with any of them. But you know what? I'm not a Republican. I'm not a Democrat. I'm a Heavenite. My party affiliation is not down here. It's in Zion. How about you? And if I'm waiting upon my Lord, I'm not going to be concerned about the political maneuverings. Yes, I should pay attention. Yes, I should be informed. But really, my primary concern is not what's happening here, but what's going to be happening there. And that's why he said to them, it is not for you, verse 7, look with me. It is not for you to know times or seasons which the Father has put in his own authority. And now here comes the cure. But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. And then something amazing happened. If you go down to chapter 2, look at verse 1. It's the last verse I want to share with you today. Pentecost is just a word that means 50th. We have tied associations to Pentecost in a modern context, but to the ancient Jewish believers, Pentecost was just 50 days after Passover. And so at Pentecost, they were all in, now what's the description? Does it say they were all dressed the same? Did it say they all liked the same music? Did it say they all liked the same foods? Do you have certain foods you can't eat? One of them for me is Special K loaf. I can't do it. And friends, I tell you, I told you I love being Adventist, right? And I've had people threaten to revoke my Adventist credentials because I wouldn't eat Special K loaf. In fact, when I go to a new district, within the first two sermons, I let my congregation know I don't eat Special K loaf. I don't care if you won an award for yours, I'm not eating it. Thank God that being in one accord doesn't mean that we all like the same things, amen? There's even people that eat Big Franks. How do you do it? My brother, I'm about to lay hands on you. I pay for this, brother. How do you eat a Big Frank? They taste like they've already been chewed. Okay. So being in one accord doesn't mean we all like Big Franks, amen? Come on, somebody in here is with me. So what does it mean to be in one accord? I'm going to reference our choir. I do not have the blessing of being an accomplished singer. I'm barely still employed by the conference. But I love to sing. How about you? And I'm going to tell you, this preacher made me sit in this throne chair. But it was the best seat in the house to be able to hear the choir. Oh, it was so sweet. And I love to sit and listen to music. Anybody, that music's just one of your big blessings in life? I'm going to tell you, on my iPhone, I've got over 1,000 songs. I love listening to music. And so whether I'm studying or driving, I love to have some music playing. And one of the things I love about music, especially four-part harmony music, right? You got those sopranos that are up here and they've got glass afraid, right? You know what I'm talking about? Those pitches are up there and I'm like, how are they doing that? And windows are afraid. But it's beautiful. I can't get up there. Right? And you got those altos and
can get tenor. I mean, I just love these parts. I used to think I was a tenor. Some guy put his arm around me and he said, brother, just blend in. So I took it to heart, you know. I just do my melody thing. Whoever's doing melody, I'm with you. But here's the point. When you have those harmonies working, right, when people are doing their different parts, are they singing the same song? Does it matter that they're doing different parts? Does it take away from the music that they're doing different parts? In fact, it adds to the music because they're doing different parts. Yes or no? Now, I did not plan this way. But Pastor Dwayne, I heard you say something about a nominating committee. Nominating committee is a season in the church that the saints dread. And it should not be that way. Shame on us that we would dread nominating committee. Nominating committee should be that joyful time that we come together and say, you know what, man, we've got so many people that want to serve, we don't know where to place them. But you know why nominating committees spend weeks on end filling positions? Because it takes weeks on end to get somebody to commit to the position. It should not be that way. Shame on us, isn't it? And maybe that's not that way here at City Temple. Maybe you guys meet for an hour and a half and it's done. Why'd I tell you the church is messed up? Because we're in it, right? Here's my point, saints. Are you doing your part? Are you a doubter this morning? Are you someone who doesn't love Jesus the way that he deserves? Are you someone who's been in the church a long time, but because you've not committed yourself to study, you really don't know what the Bible teaches? Friends, I'm not here to put you down. I'm here to say to you, wherever you are along that spectrum, whether you're completely sold out to Jesus or whether you're still trying to figure out you want to follow him, whether you know everything about the Bible or you're just getting started, the cure and the mission for all of us is the same. And that cure is, first of all, to be submitted to God in such a way that his Holy Spirit can fill me. And when the Holy Spirit fills me, there's nobody that's going to have to beg me to do my part. Does that make sense, yes or no? Anybody like to go out to eat? I've already talked about food. I'm just going to keep this going. Anybody like pizza? Come on now, where's my pizza lovers? We won't disfellowship you this week. We'll wait till next week. Now listen, there's a pizza place downtown. I'm not going to tell you where it is because then I'll be advertising on the Sabbath. But they got pizza that's that thick. It takes them 50 minutes to cook it. Elder Dwayne, pray for me, brother. I should not know that that's there. You know what I'm saying? But let me ask you this. If I have tasted that and experienced that, does that restaurant have to pay me to advertise for them? Because I have tasted, I am going to tell. Are you with me? Because I have what? Tasted, I am going to tell. If I have not tasted, can I tell you? If I have not tasted Jesus, can I tell you about him? No. So are you today a doubter? Are you someone that you wish your spiritual walk was more than what it is? I'm going to ask my brother who was playing the organ. That brother's already there. Look at that. Today, friends, I want to give you an opportunity to respond. I'm not interested in just telling people stories. I'm not interested in just spending time on Sabbath. I want to see lives transformed for Jesus Christ. And I'm here to tell you guys, don't think that just because I may serve as a pastor, that Elder Dwayne may serve as a pastor, we are not exempt from having doubt. It is alarming if you look at the statistics of the number of pastors who are leaving ministry. both inside and outside the Seventh-day Adventist Church, because they become overcome with doubt. But today I'm here to tell you that Jesus wants to make us useful doubters. Amen? So I just wonder if there's someone here today, as my brother plays, that you would like to say with me, because I stepped down from there to come here, because I want to say to you today, I want to be better than I am for Jesus. I want to taste more deeply at the table of his love, that I feel more convicted to tell others. So I wonder if there's someone here today that would like to say with me, Pastor, I too need a better walk. I too need to be strengthened. But I'm going to ask you to come down with me and Pastor Dwayne. If you would like to make that commitment today to say that, you know what, I'm a bit of a doubter, and maybe I don't love Jesus all the time the way that I should. Today, saints, I want to give you that opportunity to come down, that we can pray together, that we can recommit together, that we can be about our Father's business. What do you say? So if you find yourself in that category today, maybe it's hard-heartedness. Maybe you're stubborn. Maybe you have a bad temper. I don't know what may ail you today spiritually, but the cure is the same for all of us. Press together, saints. Come on down. Let's press together. Make room for everyone. I do not stand above you today. I stand with you, because I need Jesus just as much as you do. And as I look around this world, saints, I believe Jesus is coming soon. And I want to be ready to meet my Jesus. How about you? I don't want to just play games. I don't want to get sucked into something that keeps me from being committed to Jesus. I want to be about my Father. Is there anyone else that wants to answer God's call today to be a useful doubter in the hands of a very capable God? We have time for you. Answer the Spirit's call today. It's not my call, it's the Spirit's call. Praise God. Come on down, brother. We got time for you too. Amen. Saints, I want to go home.
Yeah.
I want to go home with my Jesus, don't you? Let us pray. And Father, Lord, if the truth be told about me, then the world would realize just how messed up I am. And Father, if the microscope came in on each of our lives, there's probably something in each of our lives that we would rather the world not know about. But Father, I'm reminded that there is nothing hidden from your eyes. In fact, the scripture tells us no creature is hidden from the eyes of him with whom we have to do. And so, Father, because it's not hidden from you, then it's really not hidden at all. We might fool each other. We might be able to come to church each week. We might be able to say happy Sabbath and then lie to each other when we say, how are you? And we say fine when really we're not fine. Lord, I don't want to play games anymore. My brothers and sisters are standing here because they don't want to play games anymore. Father, I don't know where everyone standing here is along that spectrum. But Father, we need your help today. Take away our doubt. Take away our fear. Maybe some of us are terrified about making a stand for you. Take away that terror. Father, deepen our understanding that we can know the Word of God and that we can be a blessing to others. And Father, please bring this church body into one accord. Doesn't mean everybody's going to look the same or sound the same or eat the same. But Lord, we must be the same as it relates to being on the mission for you and for your church. And so, Father, if we've got petty differences that separate us, let us set those things aside. Lord, if we are holding on to hurts from the past, let us be reminded of Jesus' words that says, if you don't offer forgiveness, then your Father in heaven can't forgive you. Lord, please change us from the inside out. take our hearts of stone, turn them into a heart of flesh. And Lord, may they be hearts that beat and live for you. Lord, please forgive us where we have fallen. But lift us up now and fill us with your Spirit. And by your grace, dear Lord, may we be about your business. And just like the world around the disciples was changed after they had this experience, may the world around us be changed because we have had an encounter with Jesus. This is my hope, and this is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you, brothers and sisters. God bless you.
Glorify you. Appreciate you.
Praise God. Praise God. Thank you so much.
Somebody ought to say amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. We want to praise God for sending Pastor Bentley today to deliver this timely, powerful, and beautiful message. It's so encouraging to hear that when Jesus was leaving, he was leaving a group of disciples. He left the church in the hands of the disciples who were full of doubt and unbelief and hard-heartedness and lack of love, but yet he was able to prepare them by the infilling of his Holy Spirit to be transformed, to be on one accord, and also to be witnesses for him in this world. And that's what we want. What a beautiful message. We praise God for that. I want you to know today that a meal has been prepared downstairs, and we're asking that you would plan to stay together so that we can fellowship together, eat together downstairs. I'm looking forward to that, and I hope that you will be able to be with us as well. We want to invite our elder who will be doing our benediction to come now, and please stand as we prepare to have our benediction.
Now, unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and ever. Amen. If you would bow your head for just a moment, I want to pray over the food because it gets congested downstairs and it's hard to get everybody's attention, so we can pray. Father, we thank you for this beautiful message today. We thank you for Pastor Bentley. We pray for him and for his family and for his church. Lord, we ask that you would bless this food that we're about to receive. May it nourish and strengthen us to do more for thee. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen.
We're going to sing as we leave. We'll give you a new song this morning. Always remember Jesus. Marcus is going to play it for you one time, and we'll join him and sing the second time around. Should be on the screen. Jesus, Jesus, always remember. Jesus, Jesus,
time always. Oh.